Vatikach Miriam Hanevia Achot Aharon et Hatov Biada Vatetsena Kol Hanashim Achareha Bitupim Uvim Cholot. And Miriam, the prophet's sister of Aaron, took the timbrel in her hand, and all the women went out after her with timbrels and with dances. A people enslaved for centuries are suddenly freed by their oppressor. As fast as they can, they gather everything up and run toward freedom. They were right to rush. Pharaoh has changed his mind and sent his mighty army after the Israelites. The ragtag mass of people are on foot, clutching all their belongings, hustling their children along with them. The Egyptian soldiers are on chariots drawn by mighty horses, and they are fast bearing down. The way forward is blocked by the sea. There it was, a promise of liberation glimmering slightly, just as quickly extinguished. Hope is lost. Have you ever felt a feeling of hopelessness? Sometimes hopelessness emerges from social structures, when all systems of authority are arrayed against us, and it feels as if there's no obvious way for us as individuals to change them. Racism, anti-immigration restrictions, punitive financial practices, institutional oppression is all around us. And sometimes hopelessness is personal, when our own world is closing in around us and it feels as if we have no options. Hopelessness is when a person with developmental disabilities has his bus service cut so he can no longer visit his father in his nursing home. Hopelessness is when another person working at minimum wage is kicked out of her one-room apartment because she can no longer afford the rent. Hopelessness is another man's struggle with addiction and his fear of losing his job or his family or both if he admits it. In Hebrew, the name for Egypt is Mitzrayim, which means narrow place. Hopelessness is a narrow place. Suddenly, everything changes. The sea parts. The former slaves rush forward to a new future. The Egyptians are swallowed up, and that particular threat vanishes. The Israelites have been redeemed. And Miriam and Moses and all the people begin to dance and make music and sing praises to God. This moment, Yitziat Mitzrayim, the crossing of the sea, is held up in Jewish tradition as a paradigm. As a people, we felt crushed. We were beaten down. We were enslaved to a harsh master. We were trapped with no hope, and God redeemed us. The moment is highlighted in many ways. In every scroll of the Torah, the song at the sea is written differently from the text around it. The script itself shows the Israelites marching through the columns of the waves, and the words are chanted to a special trope. When Chazal, the ancient rabbis, created the liturgy that became our Siddur, they focused on the concept of Ge'ulah, redemption. Twice each day, we pray for liberation from oppression, quoting from the song at the sea that Moses and the Israelites sang. Micha mocha ba'elim Adonai. Rashi, a medieval commentator, suggests that in our morning prayers, we are remembering the liberation from slavery. And in the evening, we are praying for future redemption from all suffering. On Friday night, at the Shabbat evening Kiddush, we sing Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. We intertwine our freedom from slavery with the very creation of the cosmos. And we dedicate an entire holiday to telling the story about how once we were slaves and now we are free. At Passover, we teach our children the obligations arising out of freedom. Today, what is redemption? What does Judaism in our day have to teach us in our lives about redemption? This is the question I want to explore with you. I want to unpack some of the ways that redemption is complicated. I want to raise up the ways that I think redemption can help us to be most meaningfully Jewish and most fully human in today's world. The story of redemption I just told, the story in the Torah, is a story of miracles. The book of Exodus tells us that God intervened in nature by causing the 10 plagues and then parting the sea. In doing this, God intervened in history and forged the creation of Bnei Israel, the Israelites, the Jewish people. Throughout our history, in the face of oppression, Jews yearned for redemption on the scale of the Exodus to happen once again. But the ancient rabbis warned against any human activism to bring about redemption. After the disastrous Bar Kokhba revolt, they expressly taught that redemption could only happen miraculously, biyad chazaka uvizroa netuya, through God's strong hand. When the rabbis created the Haggadah, they made no mention of Moses or Aaron or Miriam. At Passover, the Haggadah turns our focus exclusively to the divine. So, in the classical tradition, what is the human role? Exodus teaches that the Israelites marched swiftly from the sea to Mount Sinai to receive the Torah through revelation. The redeeming God did not free us from slavery to do anything we wanted. We were free to enter into service to the divine. The revelation at Sinai, the giving of the Torah, was a covenant between God and the Israelites. According to our rabbinic ancestors, our work is to uphold the covenant between Adonai and the people Israel by observing mitzvot, as revealed in the Torah and as interpreted through halakha. The rabbis taught that observance of halakha was the only Jewish path toward redemption. We were powerless by any other means. It's the Hasidim who have taken this idea the furthest. In their thinking, redemption is an interior journey toward liberation that is achieved through the observance of mitzvot. To this day, Chabad teaches that if every Jew fully observes Shabbat in a halachic manner, the Messiah will come to bring about that final and complete redemption. This is where modernity starts to complicate things. Redemption is based on the miraculous and must be mediated through supernatural revelation. Well, our ancestors accepted this as true, but it's a challenge for many of us today, and has been for many Jews since the Enlightenment. For the last 300 years, most organized expressions of Judaism have been asking and re-asking the question, how can we embrace scientific thought and maintain a religious perspective? And Reconstructionists, we ask, how can we set aside supernaturalism and retain the power and inspiration of God the Redeemer? Asking these questions is not easy, especially if you prefer simplicity. Some people step back from asking. Some born Jews choose an entirely secular or cultural identity and set aside any religious identity and all of the challenges it can bring. And some people resolve the tension by exiting the Jewish community completely and allowing themselves to be absorbed into mainstream society. Some people segregate their religious and non-religious life. They're not seeking harmonization. And others segregate themselves as much as possible from modernity to live as much as possible a pre-modern Jewish life. Reconstructionist Jews, we don't need to resolve the tension. We revel in it. We constantly ask, how can we retain the power of the Torah in this modern era? How do we stay in conversation with our ancestors in ways that can be meaningful and full of integrity for us and compelling to our children? We ask again and again because we presume that the answers will change. They are always changing. We understand that we are empowered to make certain these changing answers are substantive and relevant. We insist that it is possible to retain redemption in the modern era. We can draw strength from the power of this story. We can use that strength to work as co-creators with the divine to bring about a redeemed world. So we may revel, but we also know that this is not easy. It takes work to embrace the rigorous questioning that a rational approach requires and to presume that we can end with a stance of belief. But we choose to believe in some version of the divine, in some vision of the Jewish people, because belief affirms a beneficent universe, even as we witness horrors. Belief fuels optimism, even as we struggle in the trenches. We believe our ancestors experienced the divine at Sinai and recorded what they experienced in the Torah. That recording was tempered by their human limitations. It was shaped by their social context. We also believe that revelation is continuous. It is our work as Reconstructionist Jews to discern revelation, to enact the covenant between God and the Jewish people in ways that are meaningful for today's world. We do this work always remembering our own personal and social limitations. We do this work always seeking to recapture that redeeming moment at the sea. So, in the service of this sacred and ongoing conversation, I ask you, what could redemption mean to us? What should redemption mean today? Seamus Heaney, the Irish Nobel laureate, poet of another people's oppression, wrote, "History says, don't hope on this side of the grave. But then once in a lifetime, the longed-for tidal wave of justice can rise up. And hope and history rhyme." Progressive religious people walk a fine, even a poetic line between rationalism and belief. We believe that God is in the rhyming. In this age, when society careens between secularism and fundamentalism, we need to make the case for progressive religion. I suggest that a religious... a religious perspective invites us to ask ultimate questions. Why are we, all of us, here? Why am I here? And what am I supposed to do while I am here? A religious perspective presumes that the answers are more than individual answers. They are moderated and interpreted through community. This is community that is both horizontal. All the people we encounter every day in real and in virtual settings, and it's also vertical. Our ancestors, biological and chosen, who came before us, our children, biological and chosen, who will follow. A progressive religious perspective presumes that the community and our answers, we are constantly evolving, and that these changes can be good. They can be infused with the divine. When the Enlightenment began and the age of science and reason, humanism became a major focus. The Enlightenment wrenched our orientation away from the divine and focused it on human capacity. In our day, a religious perspective offers a critical corrective, reminding us that we should not believe that we humans are the ultimate arbiters. We know what horrors we are capable of. We must have limits, whether we believe they are imposed by God or whether we willingly self-impose them. The task of progressive Judaism is identifying what are those values so worthwhile that we should voluntarily submerge our individual desires to them. I am religious, even though I have so many opportunities not to be. I am religious because of this invitation to ask ultimate questions. Why is my religion Judaism? I am Jewish not only because I was born Jewish. I am Jewish because I believe, after the teachings of Mordecai Kaplan and others, that being Jewish enables, even requires me to be fully human and teaches me how. Being Jewish helps me to understand from centuries of teachings in multiple voices that being human is not about being solitary and it's not only about being tribal. Judaism teaches me that I am deeply interconnected to all creatures, all living creatures. With all the agency I possess, I must understand that I am a part of and I am responsible for the well-being of other living creatures, for the planet as a whole. Science aids me in this religious understanding. Again and again, science demonstrates our deep interconnectedness, our mutual interdependence. So here's my take on redemption in the modern era. We acknowledge our creatureliness, that we are limited and imperfect. At the same time, we acknowledge the immense intelligence and agency we as humans possess. I take to heart the teaching of Rabbi Simcha Bunim of Peschiska. He taught, as Rabbi Jason Klein told us, that we should carry two notes in our pockets. One should have the words, "I am but dust and ashes." The other should say, "For my sake the world was created." We are co-creators with the divine. We once were slaves and now are free. We willingly assume the obligation to work for the liberation of others. How we fulfill this obligation will look different for each of us, but for all of us, we can, we must make hope and history rhyme. All this time, I have been talking about ge'ula, redemption on a collective level, distinct from Zionism, which is a modern political movement expressed in the idiom of nationalism. I am insisting that there remains the potential for a powerful, collective, transnational experience that is deeply meaningful to the Jews and deeply significant to the wider world. There is obviously great resonance here. In North America, liberal Jews have embraced the Kabbalistic concept of tikkun olam, repair of the world, and we have raised it up to the level of commandment. We understand that the world is broken and that we are obligated to repair it. And within this collective movement, there must be space for the individual. The rise of individualism is another hallmark of modernity. The Jewish community cannot hold to only one standard for all people. We are promoting communalism, which is countercultural at this moment. And within communalism, we must make space for individual experience. We have to make space for different beliefs, including people who don't share my framing of religion. And we have to make space for different experiences, including the experience of oppression, of profound oppression that makes my optimistic interpretation of redemption look naive. Yet I insist that a vision of redemption is available to, it's even necessary for everyone. All of us, we can live with humility and awareness of our own agency. If we can approach each moment, even the most oppressive ones, with the possibility of holiness, then we may come to know that even the worst moment is temporary, and that its passage may give us even momentary redemption. We may notice the light on a plant that helps us to move to a place of greater internal expansiveness. We may interact with a kind person who helps us to remember or even to know for the first time that it is possible to act kindly. And for those of us who are fortunate to live lives relatively free from oppression, hopefully we will find our own individual passions in the arts, the sciences, the field of sports, the helping professions, passions that make our souls sing and that help us to be the most creative and most fully human and to share our gifts with others. This is redemption. Redemption on the individual level is yeshua, usually translated as salvation. Mordecai Kaplan was deeply interested in both categories, Ge'ula and Yeshua, collective and individual salvation. Kaplan's favorite name for God was the power that makes for salvation. My Reform colleague, Rabbi Ruth Sohn, marries together individual and collective redemption powerfully in her imagination of Miriam's song. I, Miriam, stand at the sea and turn to face the desert, stretching, endless and still. My eyes are dazzled, the sky brilliant blue, sunburnt sands unyielding white. My hands turn to dove wings. My arms reach for the sky, and I want to sing the song rising inside me. My mouth open, I stop. In a moment of panic, my eyes go blind. Where are the words? Where the melody? Can I take a step without knowing a destination? Will I falter? Will I fall? Will the ground sink away from under me? The song still unformed, how can I sing? To take the first step, to sing a new song, is to close one's eyes and dive into unknown waters, for a moment knowing nothing, risking all, but then to discover the waters are friendly. The ground is firm, and the song rises again. Out of my mouth come words lifting the wind, and I hear, for the first, the song that has been inside my heart, silent, unknown, even to me. Sohn evokes a collective moment in the Jewish experience to narrate a personal journey out of Mitzrayim. She mirrors the Hasidim. Miriam's journey here is interior and ultimately transformative for herself and for her people. We are all invited on our own redemptive journeys. It takes work to be a Reconstructionist. It takes work to make space for other people's interior journeys, to truly embrace diversity, to learn across differences, to live together in varying degrees of comfort and discomfort, and to embrace this as a collective process, a part of the Jewish civilization and the human experience. It takes work and also courage to put aside hopelessness and act in ways both individual and collective to create a redeemed world. For me, being Jewish gives me the groundedness of tradition. It orients me toward a sense of wonder and awe. It opens me to a newness of creation that unfolds again each day. Mechadesh betuvo bechol yom tamid ma'aseh bereshit. Being Jewish fortifies me to be unafraid of the unknown, or to be afraid and venture forth anyway. It gives me the companionship of other people on a similar journey. So I ask you, what are we being redeemed from? What are we being redeemed for? Your answer, I am certain, is different from mine. Tell me. I want to know. I want to comfort you in your suffering, in the narrow space in which you dwell. I want to be inspired by your courage and encourage you to be courageous. I want to learn with you and journey with you. I want to be enlarged by your crossing over out into Merchav Yah, the wide open expanse filled with the divine. I want to sing with you and through our joined voices praise the source of song, the source of courage, the redeeming one, so that together we can create communities working to bring redemption. Shiru Adonai, Shir Hadash.